Our speaker today is Dr. Cienciala. She is a professor of America in history, a specialist in Eastern Europe, the history of Poland, and has written extensively on Katyn and the tragedy of Katyn and the consequences. So she's going to speak to us today about Katyn and the recent Polish-Russian relations, the Thorny Path to Reconciliation.
Thank you very much.
I assume that you all know what Katyn was. Anybody not know? Good grief, that's the first time I ever had a meeting who had actually heard of it. Well, you know, it was mass murder, and it happened in the spring of 1940, and it involved not only about 14,500 prisoners of war, Polish prisoners of war taken by the Red Army and the NKVD September 39 when they came into Eastern Poland, as the Germans had already come into Western Poland. And they were put in three camps. And they were kept there. They were allowed to correspond with their families in December of late November, December 39. So not only their families, but the Polish government in exile, which was at first in France in 39-40, knew about these camps. And then suddenly they disappeared. Correspondence broke off with their families in the spring of 1940, some in March, some in April. Nothing more was heard. So after Hitler attacked the USSR in June 41, the Polish government in exile and the Soviet government restored diplomatic relations, and Stalin agreed on a quote-unquote amnesty for the Poles who were in the USSR. And the Polish army was to be raised there, fight side by side with the Red Army. But the problem was there were hardly any officers. Maybe about 300, 400 turned up in the recruiting camps. And so the Poles were looking, Polish authorities, military and civilian, asking. The Russian answer was a standard one. They had all been released. And when the head of the Polish government, General Sikorsky, came to see Stalin in early December of 1941, Stalin said they had all been released, but some of them may have gone to Mongolia. Because he knew very well what had happened to them. Then in 1943, in April 13th, German authorities publicized their finding of thousands of remains of Polish officers at Katyn. Katyn is the Russian and I think the English pronunciation. And let's see, we're going to switch this on. So, just show you the location. You have the places, distribution of the prisoners, place of extermination. You have Katyn with the people from the camp of Kozielsk. It's the only one that was known for about 45 years. The others were in Camp Starobielsk, and they were killed in Kharkov or Yukharkiv. And then there was another camp in Stashkov. They were killed in Tver and buried in Miednoye. These were very Kharkiv. So, in 1943, what was known for the next, until 1990, that's all she could do. And what happened to the others? That was something that was unknown. So, what happened, of course, was that Gorbachev, at the beginnings of a reconciliation, President Mikhail Gorbachev started the policy of glasnost, the open discussion of the past, Stalinism. And then two Russian women historians stepped in. One was Natalia Lebedeva, and the other was Valentina Pasadamova. And since Gorbachev had opened up some of the state archives, they had taken advantage and found documents. First of all, they were documents on transportation of prisoners from the camps to various places, to places where they were to be executed. And so the Russian party, Communist Party leadership, had to decide what to do. The other reason was Polish public opinion was loosening up too. There was a bit of glasnost in Poland. Polish opinion was asking for the truth about Katyn, and where were the rest of the people who were killed? So Gorbachev and his Politburo decided that since articles were coming out showing that the KGB had murdered the Poles, then also public opinion, it would be good for Polish-Russian relations to admit to this crime. And indeed, on the 13th of April of 1990, the chief newspaper of the party, Pravda, Truth, published the news that these prisoners had disappeared. It was a horrendous Stalinist crime. And who did they blame? They blamed two persons who were already dead. NKVD head at the time, Beria, and his deputy, Merkulov. They had been executed in December of 1953 by the new party leadership that succeeded Stalin. And then Gorbachev handed to General Jaruzelski, who was then president of Poland, after he had crushed Solidarity in 1981, you might remember. And then there was a collapse of communism and a compromise. Jaruzelski was elected president, and here Gorbachev is handing over the files, the names of the prisoners in NKVD lists that were sent to the three camps, and which practically the same as the names of the people later established as having been shot in the three places, Katyn, and Tvert, and Hunkov. And this was a great step forward, indeed. And after that, there was another great step forward, and that was President Yeltsin, who succeeded Gorbachev after the as the president of the Russian Federation, decided in October of 1992 to publish seven key documents, including the decision, called resolution of the Politburo of March 5th, 1940, to have the prisoners shot. Not only those in the three camps, but also about 10,000 who were held in prisons in western Belarus and western Ukraine. Talking about Ukraine, I should mention that this is the 25th anniversary of the Chernobyl tragedy in Ukraine. So we didn't take the warning. Anyway, why did Yeltsin do that? And we'll come to that in a little while. Well, he had banned the Communist Party of what was known the Russian Federation because it opposed his policies, particularly economic policies of doing some privatization and other things like that, and Stalinism, combination of Stalinism. So Yeltsin thought about it and decided that the documents on the Katyn massacre, which showed clearly that Stalin and Politburo had ordered the shooting of these people, that this would be a document proving the criminality of the Russian Communist Party and therefore justifying the ban. Well, actually, the Communist Party appealed and it's still there, making a nuisance of itself. After that, actually, a few months before that, you have a decision by an agreement between the guys of Russian Federation and Poland to publish documents that were available, not only the seven, but lots of others came out. And so you have the publication of two Russian volumes, Katyn Dokumenty, edited by Lebedeva and the Polish historian Materski. Two volumes because there was opposition in high circles in Russia to publish more than that. It's inconsistent with the Russian honor. And four volumes in Poland, also co-edited by Lebedeva and Materski. And there was an agreement to build war cemeteries for the Poles in the places of execution, but alongside cemeteries of Soviet victims of Stalinism and totalitarianism. And this was done, and the cemeteries were opened in the places of execution in the summer of 2000. Well, after that, there was a kind of stop in the movement for a while. There was a government elected in Poland that was a very right-wing government in 2004, which tried to act as a great power, supporting Georgia and Ukraine against Russia, which of course didn't go down well in Moscow at all. And I think one of the results of this was the decision of the Russian government to close down the ongoing investigation of the Katyn crime, Russian investigation conducted by the main military prosecutor's office of the Federation from 1990 onward. And then suddenly in the fall of 2004, actually even before after the elections, there was a decision unofficial decision, investigation was closed. Then in March of 2005, there was a kind of explanation at a press conference by the main prosecutor, the military prosecutor, who said there was no genocide, which some right-wing Poles insist on to now. And the perpetrators, or whoever was involved in the decision and in carrying out the decision of the Politburo, simply overstepped their authority in difficult circumstances, which was a crime subject to time limit. And furthermore, the people who had decided and carried out this crime were dead and they couldn't be put on trial and judged. Well, you can imagine that Polish opinion was pretty riled up. However, that right-wing government, which was a strange coalition of a party called Pravo I Sprawiedliwość, so justice, law and justice, and the peasant party, one of them, lost the elections of October 07. And what you have coming in is a moderate political group called Platforma Obywatelska, the civic platform, headed by Donald Tusk, who has a wonderful English name, but actually he's a Polish Kaczyn, which is a group of people, ethnic group in the Pomorze, or coastline area, from Gdańsk, a graduate in history. And he set out to improve relations with Russia and improve relations with Germany. So, we have steps to improvement. Prime Minister Putin of Russia coming to to Gdańsk, which used to be Danzig, a birthplace actually. For September 1, 2009, the 70th anniversary of the outbreak of World War II, and actually condemning the crime of Katyn at that occasion. But then things really started going in 2010. I had finished my book, co-editing the book. It's an American edition of a selection of documents which had been published in Russia and in Poland, Katyn Crime Without Punishment. If you ever want to get it, get the second printing, because that has corrections. And it has a two at the end of the number, which means second printing. Anyway, I had concluded, this was written in 07, that if Polish-Russian reconciliation over Katyn seems destined to take a long time. But in 2010, it advanced in leaps and bounds. On the 7th of April 2010, Prime Minister Putin of Russia and Tusk of Poland met at Katyn, the anniversary of the German publicization of the crime in 43. Putin again condemned the crime, and Tusk expressed hopes that it would finally be solved, resolved between them, etc., etc. And then, 3 days later, on April 10th, in the catastrophe, the then president of Poland, the right-wing president, who stayed on, although the government was different, like the United States position, somewhat like it today, he and his wife, 94 passengers representing various high officials and well-known people in Poland, crashed at the Smolensk airport. It was really a military airport, and it was not really prepared for this, but the weather was awful. There was a warning before the plane set out from Warsaw. The weather was bad. There were warnings from the controller's towers for us not to land. Finally, the pilot, for some reason, thought he saw a piece of ground and he could land. But tragically, the wing of the plane caught on a tree and it crashed in about 100 meters, I think, and burned, and then he survived. The reaction in Russia is an outflow of sympathy to Poland, to the families of the victims. And Tusk ran to there and flew and embraced Putin, and Putin embraced Tusk. But President Medvedev declared a national day of mourning in Russia for April 12th. And 2 days later, I think it was a press conference, he said, there is no doubt that Stalin and his closest collaborators ordered the murder of these homes, which had been denied for years and years and years. And still, by a Russian opinion poll, I think, over 57% still thought it was the Germans, which was the Soviet version from 1943 to 1990. And then Medvedev flew to Krakow, to attend the burial of former President Kaczynski and his wife, who were somehow there. I don't know how the decision was reached, but the Vavel Castle, the cathedral there, is usually reserved for people who have really done outstanding service for Poland, and in some way, which is hardly the case with Lev Kaczynski, but anyway. Medvedev arrived and again condemned Stalin. So the politics of this is clear. And then what happened on the 28th of April, if any of you took an interest, the seven key Katyn documents which had been published in Izvestia in October 92, and in collections of documents, appeared on the internet site of the Russian archives, including the decision of the Politburo and why and so forth. That was really a big step forward, because it made these documents accessible to many more people than had read Izvestia in October 92, I had read documents. What happened next? Well, we have a problem on the legal side, I think I should mention. On the legal side, the Katyn case did not advance one step in 2010 or up to now. Why? Because according to Russian law, especially the law for the rehabilitation of victims of political persecution, which is the case here, was said not to have any bearing on the Polish prisoners of war. Because the Russian Association Memorial, which has been investigating and showing documents of Stalinism for years, said, look here, we don't... Oh, the other thing was that the Russian courts, especially the Moscow court and various courts in Moscow and the Supreme Court of the Russian Federation, refused to acknowledge the right to rehabilitation of the prisoners because they had no documents showing from what paragraph of Soviet criminal law they had been sentenced to death. And because, this is the other thing, there was no document of evidence that they had actually been shot. Now, you know, if you go to the letter of the law and forget the spirit of the law, that happens all over the world. It happens here too. So what are the demands of Memorial and the Polish government? Memorial has really been fighting for this. Memorial wanted the reopening of the investigation that had been closed in 2005 officially, the Katyn case, Russian investigation, which had collected 183 volumes of documents. It wanted the free access, public knowledge of all the documents concerning the Katyn case that had been collected by the Russian investigation, It wanted a decision that the main military procurator's office was in the wrong legally in refusing to give all the motives and the documents of the Katyn case to making it public. Also, Memorial and the Polish government demand the individual rehabilitation of each victim. 21,857, 14,600 in the camps, another 7,300 in the prisons of West Belarus and Ukraine, of whom we have identifications for about 4,500. The rest were killed in Belarus, and the Belarusian government has refused any archaeological digs for these people to exhume what the Russians had agreed and said it had no documents. And these are the main demands, and of course the condemnation of Stalin and Politburo and everybody involved. So that's at a standstill. The most important, one of the most important demands is the legal classification of the crime. Now, Memorial and the Polish government classify it as a war crime and a crime against humanity. The right-wing Polish parties say it's genocide. There's no doubt that genocide. Well, to make up your minds yourselves, perhaps, I'd like to show you two documents. One is the famous Article 2 of the Genocide Convention of December 1948. It was accepted by the United Nations. It was really worked up by a Polish Jewish or Jewish Polish lawyer, Rafał Lemkin, who's an extraordinary person. And this is the definition. I'm not sure you can read it very well because of the light. The key words are committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part national, ethnical, racial, religious group as such. And the Polish lawyers who support the genocide charge say that the people who were killed were just such a group, killing members and all that. Well, on the other hand, have the document of the, if I can only find it, of the, yes, of the Politburo decision to murder all the Poles. This figured as a resolution put forward by Beria, but of course it must have been consulted with Stalin. Have the Russian and the English versions. Signed by, on the left, this is Stalin, Molotov. Who's this? What? And, well, I can't read them today. I know them, of course. So, this is the introduction. Among, pardon?
Yeah, it's at the bottom, in the bottom of the English, you've got it all written across the page of the signatures.
Yeah,
it's just a strange.
Let's see.
The third one is Molotov.
Molotov is this Stalin and
This is Stalin. This is Clement Voroshilov. This is Molotov, and this is Mikoyan.
Oh, thank you very much. It's all in this book, and I forgot.
Voroshilov. Clement, that is K, is Voroshilov, that is I, Molotov, and this is Mikoyan.
Can you have to scoot it over so we can read the English translation?
Yes. Large number of former Polish officers, former staff of intelligence organs, members of nationalist of counter-revolutionary secret resistance. Counter-revolutionary was a crime punishable by death, from deportation to death, resistance organizations, prisoners of war, officers and policemen, continue their counter-revolution. Gave me the organs in the Western districts and covered numerous resistance organizations. Well, actually, they were pretty much infiltrated from the beginning by the NKVD. So, this is what they recommended.
Or just maybe turn off the other lights in the room. That'd probably help a lot.
You have to lower it down a little bit. Button? Lower it? Maybe this.
It's much better.
Oh, much better.
Yeah.
To be looked without summoning the arrested, without the presentation of evidence.
Detained refugees and those who have violated the state border, a significant number of individuals who are participants in counter-revolutionary espionage insurgent organizations have been uncovered. Prisoner of war camps are holding a total, not counting soldiers and NCOs, 14,736, so we'll have the official NKVD figure later. Former officers, officials, landowners, police, gendarmes, prison guards, settlers, military settlers in Eastern Poland before the war, intelligence agents who are more than 97% Polish by nationality. And then he goes on to enumerate total of officers, and something like 4,500 plus. Rank and file police, gendarmes, prison guards, intelligence agents, 5,138. So they were by no means all officers. About one third of the prisoners in the camps were ordinary policemen, gendarme, armed policemen. So I think that puts faith to the theory of killing only the elite, which is one Polish theory, or the class theory. was a class here. Actually, the NKVD was to examine all this. Also, there were, according to Beria, about 10,000 prisoners in the jails of Ukraine and Belarus, of whom 1,000 officers, and most of them Poles, and they were also to be shot. So that's the document. Now, it seems to me the justification here, by the way, was counter-revolutionaries, enemies of the Soviet system. If given a chance and given arms, they would fight against the Soviet system. Now, this is a political military motivation, nothing to do with genocide, in my opinion. The two characteristics common to the older prisoners: enmity to the Soviet system and military training. So why, I'm coming to the end of this talk, why March the 5th? They were in the camps, taken prisoner in mid-September, late September, put in the camps in October, November. Why decide in March? They had all been interrogated individually, by the way, to determine their attitude towards the Soviet Union and towards the exiled government of Poland. And the vast majority were both against the Soviet system and recognized the authority of the Polish government in exile. My conclusion in the book, was written in the summer of 07, came out as an 07 print mark, came out in January of 08, was that it had something to do with the Western Allied plan to come to the help of Finland, who was fighting the Soviet Union. And I thought the key to it was that the Polish government in exile had agreed to the French proposal to send a Polish brigade as part of the Allied expedition to Finland. And that agreement had been made at the end of January 1940. Well, I didn't have any documents. Now, Professor Mark Kramer, who is the head of the Cold War Studies Project at Harvard, and with whom I've been in touch, said he had recently seen a document in the archives, Russian archives, which is an intelligence report exactly on that decision of the Polish government. At the same time, at the end of February, the government of Finland had decided they couldn't fight any longer. The promise of Allied help, they were to come on April 15th. In any case, the British were against it. But on 28th February, the Finnish foreign minister, prime minister, I forget now, told the French diplomatic representative in Helsinki that they couldn't fight any longer, they couldn't wait for Allied help, they were going to sue for peace. So Stalin, I think, decided, now we're going to have peace with Finland, and the Poles here are no good anymore for anything, not even for bargaining with the Polish government in exile over frontiers, which had been one of the concepts. So let's get rid of them. And like he got rid of, so all his enemies, or suspected enemies, so he shot. And as one of the advisors, the President Medvedev, said recently, Russia is one great Katyn. So it isn't only a Polish Katyn. Memorial Society has found 800 execution sites all over the USSR. It was a few years ago I mentioned it. And in all of them, there was some evidence of Poles mainly military buttons or boots, officer boots or other boots. So now we're waiting when President Medvedev met with the Polish President Komorowski in Smolensk on 11th of April this year. They decided that there would be two committees, Polish and Russian, to agree on what kind of monument, because there had been an attempt by the right wing in Poland. Actually, they put an engraved sort of shield on the big stone that's the memorial, saying that the victims of the Smolensk catastrophe were on their way to honor the victims of Soviet genocide. Mm-hmm. Well, that was a political trap for the Polish government. No government did anything until just before the meeting of the presidents, when the governor of Smolensk removed that particular inscription and replaced it with a two-language Polish-Russian inscription saying this is the place of the catastrophe, etc., etc., to attend. So at the same time, Medvedev said that he would look to the rehabilitation. And I should mention one more thing, carried away with the story, that on November 26, 2010, the Russian Duma voted by a large majority in a resolution that it was a Stalinist crime. The victims were innocent, and history has rehabilitated them. Well, that was not acceptable, neither to Memorial nor the Polish government. So when Medvedev said April 11th that he promised to look to the rehabilitation, we don't know what this means. But in the meanwhile, he did order the declassification and the transfer to Poland of 148 volumes of the Russian investigation out of 183. We do have a political progress, and we do have more documents, which however have been declared secret in Poland because the Polish investigation is still going on. So historians will have to hang on for a while. Well, that's the end of the story. We have to wait and see what happens next. Questions, please? We'll speak a bit louder.
Do you have any idea what's in the volumes of documents that were not released, or in why they weren't released?
Well, the documents, the first 67, which were handed over last May, 2010, had already been declassified and accessible to historians, but only in Moscow, and without the right of reproduction. And they didn't have anything new in them. What the others have, I can only guess, because after being transferred to Poland, they were made secret again for the Polish investigation. But I do happen to know from a Polish historian that they concern the prisoners in many ways, where they were before they were shot. Some of them were not in the camps, some of them were somewhere else. So you have more missing names coming up, names that have been missing. But I really don't know what may be in them. And I must say I was very upset to learn that they were again classified for the Polish investigation. I suggested to my colleague in Poland that those documents that have already been accessible in Moscow, at least those might be accessible on the internet. No answer. But there must be a lot of information there, because thousands of people are still missing. The Ukrainians, by the way, were also, groups of Ukrainians were also shot, those who were opposed to the Soviet government, shot in 1940. And they have not been identified. The Polish names were identified in the Ukrainian archives, and the Ukrainian archives handed these to the Poles back, I think, in 1994. So the Belarusians are not doing anything. But then, you might ask, why is Medvedev politically so forthcoming? One of the theories is that he's a rival of Putin for power. There's elections coming up next year. Another theory is, and that is actually from a statement by Dmitry Trienin, who is the head of the Carnegie Institute for Peace in Moscow. And that is, he said, Putin suddenly realized at the break of 08-09 that Russia cannot have closer relations with the European Union without removing the Polish obstacle. Because the Poles were opposing improvement between Russia and the European Union, being afraid that they would be excluded from agreements later on. So that may be a motive. And Trienin also said, Putin supports the foreign policy of Medvedev. He has entrusted it to Medvedev. But he can always change it if necessary. So, are Putin and Medvedev potential rivals? Or are they playing roles that have already been agreed on? Putin-nosed, conservative, he even said in his speech on April 20th, I think it was, that Russia does not need any liberal experiments. It needs 10 years of stability and no change. So, anyway, for the Katyn case, from the Polish point of view, the political aspect is fine, the legal aspect.